Welcome to the Gals Guide to the Galaxy podcast, where a group of gals gather for you one cool thing around our topic of the month. Is it ancient history? Is it breaking news? Is it safe for work? Well, that's up to each gal. All we know is that...
Fasten your seatbelts. It's going to be a bumpy night.
Hello and welcome back to the Gals Guide to the Galaxy podcast. It is the first Monday of a new month, and we're going to be talking about funny gals this month. And thank goodness, because wow, a lot seems to have happened in the last month, and I think we could all use some laughter. So in case our lovely listeners are tuning into this episode, maybe in like the years to come, and wonders just what in the world I'm talking about, let's see who gets this reference. For over 1,000 generations, the gal pals were the guardians of women's history and joy in the old republic, before the dark times, before the corona. Katie, do you understand that reference? No. Katie might, her internet might be completely frozen, or she's giving me a death glare. Katie, did you understand my glorious reference? No.
No.
Well, we opened the Gals Guide Library on March 6th, and it is the first ever lending library dedicated to women's history in America. And it was an amazing 11 days before we needed to close circulation because of the COVID-19 outbreak, which is okay because we're going to do a grand opening later, and maybe even like Ewoks will be there, right? Who knows?
Yay.
There you go. So we have moved our efforts back online, and we're doing our small part to encourage people to stay home and practice social distancing. And speaking of social distancing, we are recording this month's show a little bit differently. So instead of four drunk gal pals in the front room of my house, we're all connecting online from home. So the show might sound a tiny bit different. We might have a little bit of lag issues, like I think we just lost Katie. But we will figure that out in a second. So we're probably going to have like a little bit of lag issues. It's also quite possible we're actually more drunk than normal. You never know. Oh, and there might also be video of this on YouTube. So that's a special treat for y'all. Kind of a nightmare for us. So, yay! So, let's see. I'll see if I can get Katie back on here before introductions. Dun, 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 dun. Oh, coming back. She's coming back. I was about to do introductions, too.
I'm here.
Yay! No problem.
All right.
All right, so for Gal Pal introductions, I wanted to recreate a scene from Almost Famous where Sapphire, she bursts out of the backstage door and she has a bottle of champagne where I have pink drink, so how about that? And she shouts, does anybody remember laughter? Remember that one? So because I feel like that ice-breaking energy is something we need desperately right now, I will introduce this month's Gal Pals with that simple question that Roger Daltrey asked as he climbed that stairway to heaven. So first up, she is our resident oversharer whose comedic timing is far greater than she even knows. It's Katie Harris! So, Katie, before you tell us what you have been up to, do you think anyone remembers laughter?
Oh, yeah. I think it's all we have right now.
Yes.
Let me tell you, people, we're in the age of Joe Exotic. The Tiger King has exploded all over the internet, and all I do all day is look for memes.
That's your new normal?
My new normal. Not showering. I don't know what day it is.
Right. Yeah, fair. I love it.
But well, I know a good Joe Exotic meme when I see one.
See? Are you going to become a connoisseur?
Absolutely.
Nice.
I'm also falling into the stereotypical baking my own bread, every meal is from scratch.
Oh.
I'm ready to take this to the homesteading level.
Yes. I like it. Are you churning your own butter again?
We eat vegan here.
Yes. Oh, yeah, true.
So.
I didn't know if you were trying for, like, a vegan butter.
Yeah. Turn your own vegan substitute.
Right.
Dun. I am in the process of making my own vegan mayo, so that counts,
yes,
right?
Please.
Ooh, yum.
I do love a good mayo regardless. any mayo is good mayo. Let me put it that way. I haven't come across mayo I don't love. Sweet. Well, next up is our women's history artist whose savvy one-liners just crack my shit up. It's Bonnie Fillenworth. Yay!
Hello.
So, Bonnie, as we await the opening of the real-life Hunger Games, does anybody remember laughter? And what is it?
Of course they do. No, I've been seeing all kinds of memes about the toilet paper and all kinds. I have not watched the Tiger thing yet.
I haven't watched it either, but I feel like I know too much.
But it looks like it's some crazy shit. Like, I don't know. Tigers and, like, murder? I don't know what's going on.
Yeah.
My personal.
Oh, and what have you been up to, girl?
Yeah.
Well, the last week I have been, because, you know, filing for unemployment.
Oh.
And I've been gardening the shit out of my yard.
Nice.
All my little plant babies are outside right now getting some sun.
Oh.
But yeah, I've been, and, you know, bugging Trey because he's still working from home. So I go in there about every hour and just be like, hey.
What are you doing?
Are you done with work yet? I'm like, there's some things I need your help with. Are you done yet?
I'm sure that goes over well. Yeah. Fantastic. Well, next up is returning gal pal who loves a good pun. One would say she might even have a whole box of them, right? Pundora. See what I did there? See? Yeah.
That's where the name came from.
It does. I know. That's why I love it. Perfect. So before the world goes divergent, let's welcome Debbi Spotsler. Yay! So, Debbi, have you heard of this thing called laughter, and can you explain it to the next generation so they are aware of its existence?
You know, first of all, the whole next generation thing was, I'm like, okay, should I be offended because I am, like, older than you guys?
No!
And then y'all started talking about the Tiger King, and I realized that other than one mention from my housemate, I have no idea anything about the Tiger King.
Oh, so gotcha.
Maybe there is a bit of a generational gap after all.
Nah, age ain't nothing but a number.
But I was going to say, I have heard of laughter. I live laughter. I laugh at everything. Even, I mean, I sliced both thumbs in one day.
Ooh, ow.
A bad fast food work story. But while I'm in the emergency room, in there, I'm telling the guy that he should have been part of the Spanish Inquisition, and, you know, I'm cracking jokes, and they're like, you're bleeding from both thumbs deep enough that we think it might have hit the bone, and you're laughing. I mean, that's just who I am.
I like it.
And especially puns. Although, apparently, as a generational thing, now they're called dad jokes?
No, they're still puns. People don't know. It's
well,
still
I thought so, but every time I hear somebody say, this is a dad joke, and I'm like, no, that's a pun.
Yeah. When I hear dad joke, I'm like, oh, you mean awkward or bad joke.
Yeah. And no.
But sure. I dang it. Yay. So as for me, I am Dr. Leah Leach. I'm the executive director of Gals Guide, and I am not a real doctor. I am an honorary doctor. So first of all, thank you so much to the real doctors and nurses who are out there that are in the front lines right now. Second of all, I finger quotes, video helps for finger quotes, I prescribe that laughter is the best medicine. How about that? Audrey Hepburn once said, quote, I love people who make me laugh. I honestly think that the thing I like most is to laugh. It cures a multitude of ills. It's probably the most important thing in a person. So let's follow Audrey's words of wisdom and have some fun. Let's celebrate the funny gals in our lives. May they be comedians or writers or toothless grandmas. That's a shout out to Moms Mabley. Because I do love my mom's Mabel. So who wants to go first? Who wants to share their one cool, funny gal?
Me. It's time for somebody else to go first this time.
Yes, go for it, Debbi. I mean, I believe you do have to wrestle Bonnie at a later date.
You know, we'll fight this out later.
Exactly.
I did also probably pick the first one chronologically.
There you go. I like it.
Yeah.
See, so, timelines.
Yeah. So my person is Mabel Normand, or for those who like the multiple names, Mabel Ethelred Normand.
Ooh.
It took me, in all the research I've been doing, it took me till today to find her middle name.
Oh, gotcha.
They just, she's Mabel or Mabel Normand to everybody, so.
Neat. And I know nothing about her, so I'm like super excited. Like, I don't even know the name.
Well, here's the thing. I'll just warn you in advance. She's like old style Hollywood, so getting nice. To the actual truth was a little, yeah.
There was a big PR department.
Yeah, starting with her birthday. She was born November 10, 1892.
Ah.
However, her tombstone says she was born in 1895.
Oh.
So, no.
Girl needs those 3 years.
Yeah. But she was born on Long Island.
Mm-hmm.
I think so. And she was a tomboy as a child. The more I read about her, the more I thought, like, she's like my spirit mentor.
Ah.
Mabel Normand, if you ever watched the old, I don't know if you guys are old enough to remember when Noble Romans used to have the old movies in the restaurants. For those of you who are listening, who are older, right. You had been there, you might remember those.
I didn't grow up with the Noble Romans being around. I think that is probably my problem. I grew up in Michigan. We didn't have Noble Romans.
Oh, well, that could be. But if you ever watch the old silent movies, the old, like the Keystone Cops and Charlie Chaplin and stuff like that, there was always a pretty girl in there. A lot of times that was Mabel Normand.
Oh, gotcha. Oh, hey.
So, she started out working as a Butterick model. Well, actually, she went to Butterick because she found out they were hiring young girls to work in the mailroom. So she applied for that. They took one look at her and said, "You are far too pretty to work in the mailroom." And they sent her off and she started becoming a model. So she made like 50 cents an hour doing modeling.
Oh.
But
I'm assuming that was kind of good at the time. I don't
know. Not so much.
Okay, all right, gotcha.
it's terrible now, but...
Right.
But she also worked for... She was a Gibson girl, and if you have heard of them...
Mm-hmm.
I had heard of Gibson girls. I didn't know who they were. Charles Jana Gibson was an artist who drew pictures of mm-hmm. pretty women in these mm-hmm. fancy, big, giant hair things. And
for short. Advertising a lot, wasn't it? Yes. Also art, but advertising?
Yes. And she also posed, one of the other jobs she had for was James Montgomery Flagg, who you might not know the name, but he's the one that did the Uncle Sam I Want You poster.
Oh, okay.
She did not pose for that picture.
Gotcha. That'd be interesting. Artist interpretation there.
Yeah. So anyway, she heard about the moving pictures and she thought, she went to try and do that. They were hiring extras. And she got $5 for a shoot.
Ah, well, that would be better than 50 cents.
Yeah, she went there. On the first day, she met a guy named Max Sennett.
Remember that name?
He's coming up again.
Yes, I love Max Sennett.
But she goes home. She gets home really late. Her mom's like, "You are not going. Respectable women do not come in at midnight. You are never going back."
Yeah, they do.
So a few weeks later, she runs into Max Sennett. He says, "You have to come back. I know you were just an extra, but we put you into the show scene, and we can't finish the movie without you."
Ah.
So she goes back, falls in love with it. She's working for Biograph. She got paid $5. Then Biograph moved to California.
Mm-hmm.
She's out of work. So she starts working for another company called Vitagraph.
Oh, yeah.
And she became Vitagraph Debbi.
Nice.
And she made a bunch of films for them. And, like, these are all short movies.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody wants to know, who's Vitagraph Debbi? What's her real name? What's she like? And so she was already gaining all kinds of notoriety. Then Biograph came back to New York and got her, and then they ended up going back out to California. This time they took her with her because they'd shoot in the wintertime in California and in the summer in New York. I don't know.
Right. Sometimes Fort Lee, New Jersey.
Yeah, that's true. But she made a lot of movies with Max Sennett, including a movie called A Walk in the Clouds, which was 1912. It's one of the first movies ever made with an airplane. She actually got into the airplane and they showed her taking off and everything, and then the plane coming at people. It's the first time anybody had ever seen it. But in 1912, she and Max Sennett split off and decided they were going to start their own movie studio, and they founded Keystone Studios, as in the Keystone Cops and all that stuff. She developed that with him. The two of them did this together.
Oh, cool.
And so she's in a lot of the movies. She's doing her own stunts because she was really into the physical comedy. She did a lot of her own stunts, and some of them were pretty dangerous. And somebody asked her one time, you know, you're risking your life in some of these. At one point, they're in a balloon, and the balloon takes off by accident, finger quotes.
Right.
And she has to climb down the rope, and, you know, she could have died if she fell.
Mm-hmm.
And they're like, are you worried about the danger? She's like, what the hell is the difference if it makes people laugh?
It's like,
I love that quote.
Yeah.
But she was a lot of the first in the film industry. She was the first one to do the pie in the face gag.
Oh.
She got the pie. She was in the first Keystone Cops movie. She was one of the first to direct her own films.
Ah.
She was directing some of these. She also was really responsible for developing another famous actor you may have heard of, Charlie Chaplin. He was
My old namesake.
Yeah, that's true. Well, his first movie that he did for Keystone Studios, he was terrible.
Yeah.
According to Max, he's like, you're getting dumped. We're not keeping you. Mabel's like, no. Hang on to him. Max like, if you can do something to him, fine. So they worked together. She worked with him, taught him about acting because he was a vaudeville star.
Yeah.
Movies are a whole different animal. So she taught him how to do that. He developed the tramp character that he was famous for in a movie that he did with her.
Sweet.
And so he even in his biography talks about her and says that what an influence that she was on his acting and his life.
And he didn't marry her?
You know what? He tried.
Okay, there's that.
He actually he was interested in her. She's like, no, that's just not going to work out romantically. They did share one kiss.
Okay, gotcha.
But the problem is, from the first moment that Mabel met Matt Sennett, she was like over the moon for him. And they were just... Yeah, and that started immediately for both of them. He'd gotten her in the very early Biograph days, he'd gotten her a little promise ring, and it was just very cute.
Aww.
And when we get famous and rich, we'll get married. And gotcha. That was the plan.
Right.
So they're making all these movies for Keystone Studios, and one of her leading men was Roscoe Fatty Arbuckle. They made 30 pictures together.
Yeah.
And that name's going to come up later too. So,
oh, gotcha.
But she's like into everything. The very first full length film ever made was Tilly's Punctured Romance. And it starred Marie Dressler, but Charlie Chaplin and Mabel Normand were the ones that made the movie. Mm-hmm. I mean, they were just the ones that brought it, and it was just great comedic movie. Plus it ended on a girl power note because the way the movie ends, spoiler alert, sorry guys,
I mean it was what, 1915?
But
100 years guys.
Yeah, but it ended on a girl power note where they said, we don't need him, neither one of us. So she was supposed to marry Max. They finally decided they were going to get married in 1915. He got stupid the night before the wedding, and Mabel walked in on him and another actress, Mabelish, the night before the wedding.
Max. So,
Max. Yeah. Well, here's where one of those rumor things come in.
Mm-hmm.
We know that Mabel left and she had a serious head injury.
Okay.
But depending on which story, did May hit her with a vase because she got scared? did Mabel run out and in a fit of, you know, oh, woe is me, jump off the Santa Monica Pier? We don't know. We just know that she ended up with a horrible head injury, and she was out of things for like a while. And there is a rumor that has never been substantiated that she was a drug addict.
Gotcha.
If so, if it did, maybe that was the time it would have started because of the pain for all that.
Right.
But her nephew swears it didn't happen. Her nurse swears it never happened. She was not addicted to anything but chocolate and alcohol.
What, like you
I can get behind that. Yeah.
I believe that's what somebody left Katie and now they're best friends.
Yeah. But even if she had been taking cocaine and morphine, they were both legal at the time, so it wasn't as big a deal as it would be now.
Wasn't it in Coca-Cola at the time?
That's the rumor. Again, rumors. But yes. Right. Yeah.
It was definitely in your, like, cough syrup, cocaine and morphine. I mean, like...
That is true.
It was a hop, skip, and a jump away.
But anyway, so Mac's, like, heartbroken. He's like, I really screwed up. So come back. She's like, I'm never working with you again. He's like, come back. I'll tell you what. He gave her her own motion picture studio. And so it's the Mabel Normand Feature Film Company. And she was able to write, direct, and everything. She made a movie called Mickey in 1918. It's the first movie with a woman getting the top billing. It made a ton of money for that time. It made $18 million. She wrote, she starred, she directed. It was all her, and it was amazing. So Max Sennett, being the wonderful guy he was, sold the distribution rights, used the money to buy his own movie studio.
Right, sounds about right.
Yeah. At that point, she's like, I'm done. She leaves him. She signs with Sam Goldwyn and made 16 films in 3 years. And she was all excited, except it turns out that Sam Goldwyn just wanted the name.
Yeah.
And he actually was known for saying, I could throw just any script at her and it'll sell just because of the name.
Right. Yeah. So. He knew that people would come to see her regardless. Yeah.
Right. So she got really sick of making bad movies really quick. So she comes back to Mac starts working with him again, but nothing romantic ever again. She was done.
Right.
She just wanted to make good quality movies, and he would give her that. And he did. So that's when her life starts falling apart. Now, I said before that she's kind of like my spirit mentor.
Yeah.
One of the things that I've always had going on with me is that bad things, I'm never really responsible for them, but they just kind of happen around me.
Gotcha.
I don't know why that happens.
Right.
But it does. And that's kind of what happened with Mabel. The first thing that happened is 1921, Roscoe Arbuckle gets into a scandal.
Yeah, that's right.
Fatty Arbuckle. Three separate trials for manslaughter of the same woman. I don't know how that happened.
That's, yeah. Now that
and he was acquitted. Okay. Yeah, he was acquitted of it. Right. But they banned all his films. And since that was a lot of her work, her movies are getting banned.
Oh, yeah.
So then in 1922, she had started spending time with this guy named William Desmond Taylor.
Okay.
And in 1922, he was murdered.
Oh.
She was the last person to see him alive.
Oh, and we lost Debbi.
Oh, no.
No one ever saw her again. No. Oh, no.
Otto's about to lose it again, I guarantee it. People are walking past our house.
Oh, there gotcha. But we're going to have Debbi back in a second. And then we're going to be able to hear who got murdered. Yes. You left at the most awesome cliffhanger, Debbi. I'm just saying.
Okay, So let me find my, where's my.
So you were at the murders.
Okay, so I was at the murders. Yeah, William Taylor Desmond was murdered. She was the last to see him alive. And everybody saw her leave. She goes over for a drink. They're hanging out. She blows him. He walks her to her car. They're blowing kisses. Everything's all happy. He is killed later. So the police questioned her a lot because she was the last one to see him alive, except, of course, for the murderer. But the public, they wouldn't let go of it.
They decided everybody to blame loves a scandal. Her? Yeah.
So they banned her films at a bunch of places, and because that's what they did.
I guess that's the power you have.
Yeah. But there's all kinds of stories about why she was hanging out and why he was killed. The murder was never solved.
Okay.
Somebody years later wrote a tell-all biography where she said, well, if I did it, this is how it would have happened.
Oh, no.
So, yeah. But
we know what happened when OJ wrote that book.
Mm-hmm. Yes, exactly. but there's all kinds of rumors about why he died. Was it that he was, that she was on drugs and he was her drug dealer and it was a bad drug deal?
Right.
Or was it that he was actually trying to get her off the drugs and he was actually a hero? That's the story the movie studio told, but they had pretty sure that was just to sell movies.
They have money in the game.
Yeah. So she was exonerated. The police were like, you know, obviously it's not her, but people had a hard time believing it. And so it took a while for her, just as things were starting to get better. In 1924, she's at a party and her chauffeur, and there are three different names for who the chauffeur was, because it turns out he was under a false name. So there's like, was it Joe Kelly? Was it Horace Greer? Was there another one? Anyway, he shot this guy, Cortland Dines, using Mabel's gun.
Oh.
So, yeah, another scandal. What? And while she didn't do it, and the question was he being protective? Well, turns out that he was operating under another name. He was this hoodlum guy and, like, crazy. And the police said later that if they hadn't come, if they hadn't stopped him, he probably would have killed Mabel as well. Because she was there.
Yeah, right.
But anyway, so, you know, here's another big giant scandal, and she's, you know, again, people are freaking out.
Maybe she's like the lady finger of death at this point. Yeah. Every place she goes, someone dies.
And then, as if that's not all bad enough, some lady called Mrs. Georgia Church tries to sue her. Because she and her husband were getting a divorce. She sues Mabel for estrangement of affections because her husband was in the hospital the same time she was getting an emergency appendectomy.
Oh.
She never met the guy, but he was in the hospital at the same time. And so when they're splitting up, she's like, I got a way to get some money here. So she tries to sue him. At this point, Mabel's like, I'm done.
Right.
I'm just done with this. I'm done with all the publicity, and nobody's going to believe what I do anyway. I don't care. So she leaves the theater. Right? She leaves movies and goes on stage.
Okay.
She's going to do this play. And so they produce this play. She gets on there. It bombs.
Oh.
Turns out that once again, she was getting screwed. The producer, director, whichever he was, Al Woods, had tried to sell this script before. It already bombed on Broadway once.
Mm-hmm.
And he thought, well, if I put a big name in it, it'll do better.
Oh.
Still a bad script.
Right. Still bad script is a bad script. Yeah.
Yeah. So she gave up. She went back to the movies, and she signed with Hal Roach.
I know that.
And did more movies with him, a bunch more with him. Most of whom were written by Stan Laurel.
Oh, okay. Laurel and Hardy, yeah.
Yeah, and actually, there's one that Laurel and Hardy and Boris Karloff are in the movie with her. And the last one she did was actually with Laurel and Hardy as well.
Gotcha.
So,
But in the meantime, this is like 1926. Her life's fallen apart. She's bombed on the stage. She's coming back, but, you know, it's just not the same.
Yeah.
She gets drunk at a party, because it happens.
Stop going to parties.
Yeah. Well, on a dare, she said, on a dare, got married.
Oh, on a dare.
On a dare. He said, you know, I dare you. He gets drunk at the party. He's drunk too. And he gets down on his knees and he says, let's get married. She's like, okay.
I mean, this is where good decisions happen.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. So they all go off. They get married. They immediately wake up, sober up. Oh, crap. What have we done now?
Yeah.
So they never lived together. They both regretted it. But they didn't want to get a divorce because yet another scandal. She's like, I can't deal with this. So they just maintain separate homes and live their lives.
They're like, well, I guess I have this now.
Yeah.
Cool.
So in the meantime, Max Sennett has never stopped carrying a torch for her. He's gobsmacked. And he later in life, as he's talking about it, all his things, he said the biggest regret in his life was that he hadn't married her.
Oh.
So she's finally kind of getting her life back together, and she's diagnosed with TB.
Oh no, she got the tuberculosis?
Well, it turns out she'd had it. Either some people say she got it while they were filming Mickey.
Well, it was the 20s disease.
Yeah. But other people also said she'd had it since she was a child.
Yeah.
I heard one source said 10, one source said 15. Charlie Chaplin said she'd had it since she was 15.
Yeah, I don't believe anything Charlie says.
You know, yeah. It's Hollywood. You can't believe any stories. Yeah. But we do know she was diagnosed with it.
Right, yeah.
1927, and that pretty much ended it. The last movie she made was called, I thought I wrote it down. But 1 Hour Married. There's no
the proof irony there.
Hired by real life.
Yeah, I know.
Was it a documentary?
They don't know because they've never been able to find a copy of the movie. Or any proof that it ever existed. But there's a lot of people that say, oh yeah, no, she made it. So,
gotcha.
Again, we don't know.
Right.
So she ended up going into a sanitarium and died in 1930, on February 23rd, 1930, when she was 38 years old.
Aww.
So.
38 with the tuberculosis.
Yeah, it's really sad. And again, rumors. Did she die of a drug overdose? Da, 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 da. But the cause of death on her death certificate says tuberculosis. Plus, she was in a sanitarium run by nuns, and they would not have gone for the whole drug thing. So, and she was in there for a year. So, yeah, it was tuberculosis.
Mm-hmm.
But I found a couple of quotes from her that I really liked. One is, I had no precedent, nothing to imitate. I created my own standard of fun.
Oh.
I love that. That's like,
cute. You know,
a model for my life.
Yes, exactly. You determine your own determination of fun.
Exactly. The other one she said was, just because I'm a little, well, you know, different, people believe anything weird about me.
I can see that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, but for her legacy, I looked it up on her website, the fan site,
mm-hmm.
and she made 196 movies plus the 1 Hour Married. If that one's true, 197 movies.
Nice.
She has a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. There was a sound stage dedicated to her 10 years after death. She was all geared up to start making talkies.
Yeah.
They were excited. She's like, you have a good voice. She can actually do this. She was not like... what's her name in Singing in the Rain that had the funky voice. She actually was going to be able to do this. And then the TV just messed all that up.
No.
There was also a Broadway musical made in the 70s called Mac and Mabel.
That's about her?
Yeah, it's about Mabel Normand and Max Sennett. And I didn't, I had never heard of the play.
Yeah.
But I'd heard the songs. Some of my favorite songs are in there. I Won't Send Roses.
Gotcha.
You've heard that one. Oh, no. Maybe you haven't, but Time Heals Everything and Tap Your Troubles Away. I know all those songs, love all those songs. they're all from that same play. I was like, oh, cool. And there's a song written about her, sung by Stevie Nicks.
Yes.
Stevie Nicks, and that needs to be in the show notes, a link to that
song.
Yeah,
I will totally put it in the show notes, yes.
But she did it because when she was trying to get... she heard about Mabel Normand, and her story about being on drugs is what inspired Stevie Nicks to come clean.
Oh.
And she used Mabel Nicks as her heroine. So, you know, really cool story.
I like how you said heroine, but you really mean it in a different way.
That's true. Hey, I made a
my
fun.
Heroine. Wait,
I made
wait.
A fun.
You did, Pandora. Good job.
I can pontificate with the best of them, even when I do it unwittingly.
Fantastic.
But that's pretty much everything I have about her.
That's amazing. So,
pretty amazing, yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
It's funny, I went with her in the beginning just because I thought, you know, really cool, really used to like those old movies, and mm-hmm. I was fascinated about the women behind him, and then I go through it, she's like this amazing woman. I'm like,
yeah,
I scored.
It's worth going down the rabbit hole of history knowledge.
Yes, absolutely.
You never know how many murdered bodies you'll find.
I have
and
no
how many parties you go to.
Parties. That's right. I'm just going to get married to the meta party and something to do.
Yeah, why not?
I like it.
Yeah, well, considering my first husband was a guy I'd only known 3 weeks, I can identify with that part.
See? There you go. Fantastic.
Okay.
No, well, I love it.
Yeah.
Do you ladies have any questions?
That's crazy. Yeah.
Fantastic. Well, okay, I opened
super
it.
So interesting.
I will wrap it up. Dun, dun, dun. Well, that wraps it up for us this week. Join us next week as our next gal pal shares her one cool funny gal as the Gal's Guide to the Galaxy. Oh, let me try that again.
This almost. Is why you should not have gotten in front of me and let me do it.
Oh, you're fine. It's like, it's not, it's a word that I, or it's a sentence I say every month. But anyway. All right. And I'll try this again. Well, that wraps it up for us this week. Join us next week as our next gal pal shares her one cool funny gal as Gal's Guide to the Galaxy podcast continues. Thanks for listening. There we go. That's how you do a thing. For show notes, links, and images from this week's show, visit galsguide.org. Want exclusive stuff like deleted bits and major bloopers? Become a Gal's Guide patron today. Thanks for listening.